In this video, we're going to look at the core themes of ecologism. And these core themes are ecology, holism, sustainability, environmental ethics, and self-actualization. Ecology is the study of the relationship between living organisms and the environment. And all ecologists believe that nature is an interconnected whole, which can embrace humans, non-humans, as well as inanimate objects. It stresses that life, plants and animal, including humans, are sustained by self-regulating natural systems called ecosystems, which comprise of living and non-living elements. The entire natural world is made up of a complex web of ecosystems, the largest of which is the global ecosystem, commonly called the ecosphere or the biosphere. Ecologists would say that all ecosystems tend towards a state of harmony or equilibrium through self-regulation, and this process is known as homeostasis. However, ecologists argue that this equilibrium, this homeostasis, has been upset and the balance of nature has been changed, and this threatens environmental disaster. Examples of how this balance of nature is threatened is through the exponential growth in human population, the depletion of finite fuel resources such as coal, oil and gas, the eradication of the tropical rainforests, the pollution of the natural environment, the use of chemicals, additives and species extinction. Underpinning these developments, these examples of how the environment is threatened with disaster, is the concept of anthropocentrism, the belief that human needs and interests are of overriding moral and philosophical importance. We humans are the centerpiece of life on Earth, and everything on Earth is there for our pleasure or for our purposes or for our resources. To counter this, ecologists advocate an ecocentric approach, which gives priority to the maintenance of the ecological balance rather than simply the achievement of human needs. Although all ecologists would agree to some extent with the support for an ecocentric approach, they differ to the extent to which this concept should be implemented in practice. Nace coined the terms shallow ecology and deep ecology to describe the differences. Shallow ecologists, who could also be described as maybe environmentalists, similar to liberal feminists, could be described as reformist, in that while they accept the importance of the natural environment, they seek to reform human behavior, our behavior, to reduce the damage being done. Shallow ecologists have been criticized as merely ecology light, or a light form of ecologism, or an enlightened form of anthropocentrism. And all they do is merely seek to maintain the health and prosperity of people in developed countries and only address the effects, but not the causes of the ecological crisis. Deep ecologists, on the other hand, would completely reject anthropocentrism in favor of ecocentrism. And they deny the belief that the human species are superior or more important than any other species, or in some cases to nature itself. Deep ecologists would give priority to the maintenance of nature, not human needs and ends. As such, deep ecology is much more revolutionary and radical than shallow ecology, and it proposes a new moral vision to transform the relationship between humans and nature. It has been criticized, as we'll see later on, for advocating irrational or even mystical doctrines and unrealistic solutions to the environmental crisis. Second core theme is that of holism. One of the main targets of criticism by ecologists has been science, or specifically what called scientism. And scientism is the belief that the scientific method is the only value-free and objective means of establishing truth. In his book, The Turning Point, Capra described this idealization of science as the Cartesian Newtonian paradigm. Prior to the 17th century, nature was seen as organic, often inexplicable. But then, with the development of science, humans began to see nature as a machine made of separate parts, parts which could be analysed and explained through scientific investigation. And like any other machine, nature could be tinkered with, repaired, improved, or even replaced, with increasingly dangerous consequences for the planet. Rejecting this reductionism of science to reduce everything to the sum of its parts, ecologists sought to promote the concept of holism, a belief that the whole is more important than the parts, and that each part only has meaning in relation to the other parts, and ultimately in relation to the whole. Some would argue that the development of what has been called new physics, pioneered by Einstein and developed further by Boole and others, has moved towards this approach. They see the physical world not as a collection of individual molecules or atoms, but as a system of network of systems. Capra himself drew attention to the parallels between the ideas of modern physics and some Eastern mystical religions such as Zen Buddhism, which also preaches the oneness of things. Other writers have seen ecological parallels with monotheistic religions such as Christianity and Islam, all of which regard humankind and nature as products of divine creation, with humans merely God's stewards on Earth, with a duty to cherish and preserve the planet. The most influential concept for modern ecologists, drawing on pre-Christian spiritual ideas, has been the concept of Mother Earth. The Gaia hypothesis by Lovelock, after Gaia, the Greek goddess of the Earth, sees Earth as a living entity that exhibits self-regulating behavior to maintain its existence. In effect, Gaia has maintained a global homeostasis despite major changes that have taken place over time. It's a very radical, deep ecological vision, and it argues that the health of the planet matters more than any individual species. And Lovelock suggested that those species that have posed a threat to Gaia are likely to be extinguished. In a later book, Lovelock argued that with the rise of global warming, humans, the planet may soon reach a tipping point where the damage being caused is too great for Gaia to regulate in its present form. But Gaia will survive, but humans may not. The third core theme is that of sustainability. And sustainability is the capacity of a system to maintain its health and continue to exist over a period of time. Many ecologists criticize traditional political creeds such as capitalism and socialism as promising the electorate endless material prosperity and growth. They describe this approach as industrialism, a system characterized by large-scale production, the accumulation of capital and relentless growth. It is materialistic and idealizes science and technology. Ecologists would argue simply that the idea of endless growth and consumption is unsustainable, as we live in a closed system, the Earth itself, and in which resources are finite. They will eventually run out. Balding used the metaphor of Earth as a spaceship in which we are traveling with no possibility of obtaining other resources other than those on the spaceship. This is a closed system with no external inputs, and all closed systems show evidence of what's described as entropy, which is the tendency of all closed systems towards decay or integration. Typical of this is the energy crisis. In maintaining and improving our lifestyles, we have exploited the Earth's fossil fuels, which are non-renewable. Schumacher in 63 used the analogy of income and capital to describe what we are doing. We are treating fossil fuels as a source of income, as if they are replenished or paid back on a regular basis, whereas we should really view them as capital, and that when we take from them, the amount continues to shrink and eventually there will be nothing left. While this process of entropy or decay may be inevitable, its effects can be slowed down or delayed by effective application of the principle of sustainability, this idea of the capacity of a system to maintain its health over a period of time. Because sustainability sets limits on human ambitions and requires that production does as little damage as possible to the global ecosystem. As with other things, however, ecologists differ in their approaches to sustainability. Reformist or modernist or shallow ecologists are said to only support a weak form of sustainability, for example, recycling or the use of hybrid cars or lead-free petrol. which merely seeks to reconcile ecology with the features and benefits of existing capitalist society. Yes, we can have sustainability, but for us it means just getting richer slower. It doesn't really address the effects, it only addresses the effects and not really the causes of the environmental crisis. Radical or deep ecologists are said to support strong sustainability, which rejects this pro-growth doctrine, and they argue for a zero growth option, the need to preserve natural capital. Many argue for a post-industrial age in which people return to live in small, decentralized communities, rejecting industrialism and modern technology. The fourth core theme is that of environmental ethics. And traditionally, ethics and morality would have been judged in human terms. It would have been an anthropocentric vision. So ecologists have sought to challenge this conventional or traditional ethic and moral thinking in three ways. Firstly, ethical issues, which some but not all traditional creeds tend to neglect, is the ethical question as to what are our moral obligations towards future generations. Ecologists extend the notion of human interest to encompass the human species as a whole, and they make no distinction between present and future generations. This is sometimes termed futurity, which is a concern for the future, implying that actions in the present should be judged not just on the present, but on their impact on future generations. This in turn leads to a sense of ecological stewardship, the notion that each generation has a duty to protect and conserve the environment for the benefit of generations to come. This idea of a moral obligations to future generations is clearly closely related to the idea of sustainability. Eco-conservatives in particular might link this to their ideas of tradition and continuity and the notion that the present generation are merely custodians of the wealth that has been created. Burke's notion of a society that is the partnership between those living, those to be born, and those who are dead. Eco-socialists might argue that concern for future generations reflects a concern for a common humanity and a compassion that extends through time. A second way in which ecologists have sought to challenge traditional environmental thinking is whether or how moral standards and values that we apply to humans should also apply to other species. Some ecologists would argue that we are guilty of speciesism, the belief in the superiority of one species, i.e. us, over another species or all of the species, by denying their moral significance. An area in which this approach is prominent is the case of animal welfare. And Pete Singer, from a utilitarian standpoint, adopted by ecologists, argue that as animals are sentient beings able to feel pain, the interests of humans should not be put above those of animals. A third way in which ecologists have sought to challenge conventional ethical or moral thinking is deep ecologists, who would go much further by suggesting that all of nature has a value in its own right. Leopold's land ethic argued that a thing is right when it tends to preserve the integrity, stability, and beauty of the biotic community. It is wrong when it tends otherwise. Goodwin proposed a green theory of value, which held that resources should be valued because they result from natural processes rather than human activities. For example, the engineering of landscapes should be avoided as it imposes human designs on natural features. Deep ecologists reject any notion of dualism, the idea that humans are somehow separate from the natural world. They argue that all organisms and entities in the ecosphere are of equal moral worth, each of them being part of an interrelated whole. This is known as biocentric equality. And the final core theme is that of self-actualization. Ecologists would argue that modern society is driven by materialism, an emphasis on material needs and satisfaction, and also related consumerism, which implies that happiness is related to levels of material consumption. In many respects, deep ecologists, eco-socialists, and eco-anarchists in particular, ecologism can be seen as both an anti-materialist and an anti-consumerist doctrine, because both of these have provided the basis for environmental degradation, as consumer society encourages people to put short-term needs satisfaction ahead of long-term ecological concerns. In effect, nature itself has been commodified. It is argued that the growth of concern over environmental issues in the 60s was a reflection of post-materialism, the idea that as people have become materially affluent and well off, quality of life issues and concerns tend to displace economic concerns. Quality of life issues might include concern for gender issues or world peace or animal rights and the environment. As such, ecologism can be seen as one of the new social movements that have sprung up in the second half of the 20th century. Ecologists, and particularly deep ecologists, have embraced this idea of a spiritual dimension to ecology, that ecology is about self-actualization. Fromm described this as a move away from a materialistic or having attitude of mind to the experience of being, where satisfaction is gained from experience and sharing and creativity. Buddhism, which has been described as an ecological philosophy in its own right, promotes the idea of no self, and that fulfillment involves rising above the self and recognizing that each person is linked to all living things and to the universe itself. So the five core themes of ecologism are ecology, holism, sustainability, environmental ethics, and self-actualization.